Cuando los libros cobran vida, sus historias se convierten en películas.
Todos tenemos demonios.
¿Qué hiciste?
¡Suéltame, soy tu nieta!
Una vez que pones tu ira en el aire, no puedes devolverla.
Familia.
Debe pagar por lo que hizo.
En julio, prepárate para un mes de libros, cámara y acción.
Terminaré con este capítulo.
Por Lifetime. Buenos días a todos. Bienvenidos. Para una mejor experiencia, les solicitamos por favor que mantengan sus micrófonos en mute. Todo el material que presentaremos puede ser utilizado para difusión y promoción. Muchas gracias y que disfruten del evento.
I don't even get a hug.
Oh my God!
Yeah, it's been a long night and the mirror's telling me to go home.
But it's been Tell me how to find Levi and Vereen's family.
You know what would happen if anyone found out about you?
Never get anything past you, could I, Kathy?
Like it or not, we are sisters.
That doesn't make us friends.
Muy buenos días, América Latina y Brasil. Estamos felices aquí en Lifetime de darles la cordial bienvenida a otra reunión. Esos eventos de prensa que se han convertido en eventos semanales, en los que ustedes y nosotros vamos a poder conocer más de cerca a los productores, a los directores y los actores. En este caso, a un director, actor y productor que ha sido una imagen muy importante en la cultura pop por muchos años, Jason Priestley, más conocido por la serie de Beverly Hills 92-010 y sobre todo como sus roles de actor en Private Eyes y también ahora como actor y director de una de las sagas más importantes de Lifetime Movies, la de Castiel. Para hablar de Lifetime Movies, para hablar de por qué es tan importante hablar de luces, cámaras, acción o libros, cámaras, acción, porque muchas de las películas de Lifetime Movies son inspiradas en famosos bestsellers como la colección de B.C. Andrews y la famosa saga de Flores, Castiel y ahora Ruby Landry. Vamos a presentarles a ustedes a la Senior VP de Programación y Producción, la señora y amiga de todos, Carmen Larios.
Hola César, muchísimas gracias. Muy buenos días a todos. Gracias por acompañarnos el día de hoy. Para saber un poquito más de lo que estamos presentando en Lifetime, sobre todo en Lifetime Movies, que tenemos esta gran saga, como bien dijo César, escrita por B.C. Andrews. Nosotros hemos tenido un gran éxito y agradecemos a toda nuestra audiencia, gracias a ustedes también que cuentan estas historias, con esta franquicia de Lifetime Movies que trata de los libros y la literatura que la lleva a la pantalla. Nosotros la hemos llamado Libros, Cámara y Acción, porque así como el nombre lo dice, de los libros, nos llega a la pantalla este contenido. Y B.C. Andrews es una de las figuras más emblemáticas que todos nosotros hemos quizá escuchado a través de Flores en el Ático o la saga Castiel. Y en esta ocasión, en el mes de julio, tenemos el estreno exclusivo en Lifetime y Lifetime Movies de la saga Landry. ¿Y qué es la saga Landry? Bueno, la saga Landry son una serie de libros escritos por B.C. Andrews con muchísimo éxito y que llegan a la pantalla de Lifetime. Son 4 películas: Rubí, Destello en la niebla, Fulgor oculto y La joya secreta. ¿Y de qué trata? Bueno, pues esta gran saga, esta impresionante historia, habla de la familia Landry y de todos los secretos que hay en los pantanos de Nueva Orleans y cómo una familia oculta tiene secretos y todo lo que sucede a esta familia. Y nosotros en Lifetime estamos muy orgullosos que a través de esta franquicia que nosotros llamamos de libros a la pantalla, la vamos a poder llevar a toda nuestra audiencia en América Latina, tanto en Brasil como en el resto de todos los países en América Latina. Y para esto, les vamos a enseñar todo lo que tenemos, les vamos a enseñar los promos, les vamos a enseñar un adelanto de esto. Y tenemos a una persona muy importante que ha sido clave en la icónica saga anterior, que es la saga Castell, que también vamos a tener en Lifetime el mismo mes de julio y repetir posteriormente durante el verano. Y Flores en el Ático es otra de las sagas de V.C. Andrews que hemos estrenado año con año repitiendo porque ha sido un éxito total para todos nuestros televidentes. Y sin más, les dejo a que vean una probadita de esta nueva saga que les estoy contando y que puedan verlo ustedes mismos. Así que muchas gracias, César, y libros, cámara, acción, los dejo con el video.
Giselle Dumas conoce a Ruby Landry, tu hermana.
Algo malo va a suceder.
Supe que eres una chica del pantano.
¡Ah! ¡Son animales!
Si todo resulta como quieres, mereces que te culpen.
Cuando hablamos de V.C. Andrews, hablamos de una de las colecciones más importantes en la literatura americana, pero también hablamos de unos grandes éxitos a nivel cinematográfico con Lifetime Movies, porque tienen los mejores ingredientes para engancharnos en su comienzo. Drama, traición, pasión, lujuria, incesto, sí, dije incesto. Además de romance, también hay romance, y mucho misterio. Todo esto en una saga de libros que parece nunca agotarse, porque en cada colección que Lifetime Movies presenta, vamos a poder disfrutarlo, no solamente a nivel lineal en estreno, sino también van a estar disponibles inmediatamente a partir del día de hoy en VOD. Todos los títulos de la saga de las flores, los títulos de la saga Castell con Jason Priestley, y también van a estar luego del estreno de Ruby Landry, como dijo Carmen, todos los estrenos de esta increíble y fascinante aventura literaria y cinematográfica con Lifetime Movies. Vamos ahora a presentarles y recordarles a cada uno de ustedes qué ocurrió en la saga de las flores y en la saga de Castell.
¿Ni siquiera un abrazo?
Hubo un accidente.
Podemos ir a vivir con su abuela.
¡Fanático!
¿Cuánto tiempo?
No lo sé exactamente, tal vez unos días o una semana.
Me casaré, mamá.
Yo no tengo una hija.
Renunciaste a nuestro amor por dinero. Nos encerraste en el ático por 3 años.
Logan, él es mi abuelo político, Tony.
Por favor, siéntanse en su casa.
¿Estás bien?
¿Cuántos secretos aún escondes de mí?
Todo lo hice porque te amo.
¡Soy tu hija!
La familia lo es todo, y ahora somos familia.
Mientras más intentes huir de esto, con más fuerza te seguirá.
Esto es solo el principio.
Libros, cámara, acción. Este es el ciclo más uno de los ciclos más fascinantes que tienen Lifetime Movies para toda América Latina y en Brasil. ¿Cuándo van a poder disfrutar de la maratón de todas estas películas, de la saga de las flores, la saga Castell y la saga Landry? Exactamente en Brasil el día 24 de julio y en América Latina el 25 de julio. Y podrán disfrutarlo también en VOD a partir del 1 de julio. Exactamente a partir del 1 de julio, en solo pocas horas, van a poder disfrutar de lo mejor de la saga de V.C. Andrews en Lifetime Movies en VOD. Así que pidan su operador inmediatamente. Ahora vamos a compartir con ustedes un video que preparamos para contar en algunos minutos la gran historia de este increíble ser humano y sobre todo actor que desde muy joven sabía que la actuación era lo suyo. Es hijo de una famosa actriz, hermano de otra reconocida actriz, pero además desde muy niño le encantó estar en el escenario. Y de adulto lo ha demostrado no solamente dentro del escenario, sino detrás del escenario, incluyendo en Lifetime Movies. Así que vamos a conocer más de cerca a nuestro invitado de hoy, Jason Priestley.
Jason Priestley saltó a la fama gracias a su rol de Brandon Walsh en la serie de los 90s Beverly Hills 90210. Allí se consagró como actor, un rol que no ha dejado de ejercer desde entonces, participando en más de 100 producciones entre series y películas, entre ellas Dear Christmas de nuestras Lifetime Movies de Navidad,
ho, ho, ho,
y como Tony Tatterton en la saga Castiel de V.C. Andrews para Lifetime.
Oh, and my dear heaven, so lovely to see you back at Farthing.
Además, Jason se ha involucrado mucho en el trabajo detrás de cámaras, tomando los roles de productor, escritor y especialmente en la dirección, que comenzó desde Beverly Hills.
Lovely, you look fabulous, darling.
Y para Lifetime, dirigió la tercera película de la saga de la familia Castile, donde además es protagonista.
Let me show you something.
También escribió su autobiografía que se publicó en 2014 y continúa sorprendiéndonos con su versatilidad. Sin duda, Jason es un artista integral y nos sentimos orgullosos de que pertenezca a la gran familia de Lifetime.
Now is the time to introduce you to Jason Priestley. Hey Jason, how are you? Everybody in Latin America and Brazil wants to get to know you better.
Hey, everybody.
Jason, tell us, because we have to break the ice, and no matter what we do, we cannot escape from it. So everybody wants to know, how was your life during the years of Beverly Hills 92.10?
Well, you know, we certainly had a lot of fun making that show. It was a great place to go to work every day. You know, it was... It was as fun as it looked on television.
But you also were not only heartthrob and one of the most biggest sensations around the world, but also you start also directing episodes. So tell us, how was the transition from actor and director at the same time?
I did. I started directing episodes of that television show in the third season of that show, and by the time we finished that show, I had directed more episodes than every other director on that show except for one. So I was very busy behind the camera. I also started producing on that show and executive producing on that show. So I really looked at that show as a great opportunity to not only become a better actor and really learn that trade, but also take advantage of every opportunity that show gave me. And certainly working for an executive producer as iconic as the great Mr. Aaron Spelling, I really wanted to take advantage of that opportunity and learn everything that I could from him.
And you did very well, because you're still directing and acting, so we are very proud of you. One of the things that struck our attention was that you were also in a movie called Zoom that was part of the Toronto Film Festival with Gabriel Garcia Bernal, also from Mexico. So tell us, how was the experience?
Well, Zoom was a ton of fun for me. You know, I got to shoot part of that movie in Toronto, and I got to shoot part of that movie in Brazil. We shot in Sao Paulo, and we shot in Trindade and Paraty, and it was an incredible experience to go down there. I got to work with Mariana Jimenez, a wonderful Brazilian actress, and we had a great time making that movie. It was a super cool movie. I don't know if many people have had the opportunity to see it, but it's a really interesting film that I really encourage people to see if they haven't had the opportunity yet.
What are your best memories from Brazil? Since everyone wants to know, and everybody was surprised that not everybody knows that you were already in Latin America before. So tell us about your experience in Brazil.
Well, you know, one of my favorite remembrances of being in Brazil was the actual town of Paraty. It is, you know, as I'm sure you know, you've probably been there. It's a UNESCO World Heritage Site, and it's you know, as it was back in the 1600s when the Portuguese landed there and built that little town. It's really an incredibly special place, and if anyone ever has the opportunity to go there, I strongly suggest it. It's a really magical little place.
Another one of the unique aspects that not everybody knows about your intervention or your transition to pop culture was the fact that you were in one of the Britney Spears videos called Boys. How was that? I have to ask.
Yes. Yes. Yes, I was. Myself, Mike Myers, Lorenz Tate, we were all in that video, and we all had a lot of fun that day, you know, dancing with Britney and, you know, goofing around on set. It was, you know, it was a lot of fun. Britney is a really sweet girl, and you know, us guys just had a lot of fun that day, and you know, it was funny.
It looks like a field trip. It looked like you have too much fun, to be honest with you. So that's why I have to ask, yeah. How was the boys' experience?
Yeah, it was. It was fun.
It was hysterical. So now let's talk about Lifetime and B.C. Andrews. B.C. Andrews is a very prolific author and with so many movies and so many books about incestuous relationships, basically, and all the things that go south in the South. And we want to know, how you were called and how you were casting or how you were attracted to this particular role?
Well, the executive producer, Dan Angel, is an old friend of mine. And we were looking for an opportunity to work together. We've tried to work together several times in the past. And he approached me with these books and asked me if I'd be interested in tackling the role of Tony Tatterton. I mean, Tony is was a role that was going to be very challenging because of the fact that he role spans spanned about 35 years in the three of the five books that Tony appeared in, and you know, it was a very challenging role in that Tony. You know, Tony obviously was a very difficult character because of the sociopathic tendencies and because of the incest and because of the alcoholism and because of all of it, right? So I think he knew that he needed to find an actor who had a certain built-in likability to be able to bring to that character to sort of make him palatable, even though he was doing a lot of not so palatable things. And for me, there were a lot of challenges in there that I was willing to take on because I always enjoy roles like that are I like playing. Difficult characters like that these days, and I found Tony to be very challenging, and I also enjoyed the challenge of the aging process that we took on, and there was a wonderful makeup artist named Pearl Louie who did all the aging makeup for me in Vancouver, and a fantastic hair team in Vancouver led by my old friend Russell. Who's a very old dear friend of mine, also in Vancouver, who tackled that.
But this was not only a challenge.
I got to work with old friends, which was nice. What's that?
This was not only a challenge, but what was also a big departure from everything that you have done before.
Go ahead.
But also, in fact, that was not only a departure and was a big challenge, you make it also. It was easy to hate you, but you were likable at the same time. How you did that?
Well, that's the challenge, right? I mean, that's always the challenge with roles like that. And I think that's where the challenge always comes in. Like you always have to remember, you know, as an actor, you always have to be in love with the character that you're playing. And you always have to remember that so many people like that, even though they're doing despicable things, they think they're doing the right thing. And they can justify the actions that they're doing. So you have to, as an actor, you have to figure out, you know, what's the psychology behind what they're doing, and why are they making the decisions that they're making? And so there's a lot of homework that you have to do, and a lot of the psychological research that you have to do to figure out why these characters justify the decisions that they make. And so that's the kind of work that I end up doing as an actor to play characters like that.
But you went beyond that. You were not only the leading male actor, you stepped in as a director. How was that combo overall?
I guess I just like to always put myself in situations where I overextend myself. But directing the film of Fallen Hearts was it actually turned out to be a lot of fun. Because Annalise is such a wonderful actress, and having the opportunity to work as closely with her as I got to was super fun. Along with everybody else in that film, we had an exceptionally talented cast, and also there were other challenges in that film. I had to work with a lot of special effects teams to create the whole lion attack sequence, and so there were a lot of really rewarding challenges for me as a director to get to tackle in that film, and so that definitely made it all worth it for me. Also, we shot all those films in Vancouver, which is my hometown, so I got to go and spend 8 months in my hometown, and spend a lot of time with my family and with a bunch of old friends, and that definitely makes experiences like that all the better for me.
Talking about Canada, even though you are American now, and talking about Canada, you also have a role as a director sometimes, and also the main character of a very successful series that we can also watch in the US called Private Eyes. So tell us about Private Eyes, and tell us about what Jason is doing these days.
We just finished filming our fifth season of Private Eyes. Private Eyes is, thankfully, has been an incredibly successful show, not only in Canada and the US, but in 180 some countries around the world. It's been a remarkably successful show all around the world, which has been incredibly gratifying for all of us who work on the show, because we all really love making the show. So it feels really good that that people seem to enjoy it all around the world. Other than that, I mean, that show seems to take up most of my time these days. Which is great for me. The show's tons of fun to make, and so I don't mind that.
Also, everybody wants to know, you are a family man with two kids, a beautiful marriage. Yep. You also directing, you're acting, and we are in pandemia. How's pandemia in Canada and everything else?
How's which in Canada? I'm sorry?
The COVID situation, the pandemic. How is the pandemic over there?
It's in Canada. It's certainly in Toronto. It's been a little more difficult. The vaccine rollout has been a little more of a challenge in Canada. In America, they've been incredibly aggressive about the rollout of the vaccines, and life seems to be getting back to normal in America a lot faster than it seems to be getting back to normal in Canada. But I think probably mid-July, maybe the beginning of August, things will be getting back to normal in Canada, thankfully.
Perfect. Are we ready for a question and answer from the media outlets?
Sure. Are we 100%. Ready? Yeah.
Perfect. Sure. Carmen, you are with us too? Perfect. Let's go to Q&A. Vamos a preguntas y respuestas.
Yes, we're going to start with Paola Acevedo from Colombia, Canal 1.
Okay, Paola.
Hola, buenos días. Bueno, qué placer estar acá con todos ustedes. Quería hacer dos preguntas para ti. Quería preguntarte, tú mencionabas al principio cómo te ha gustado hacer parte, como Tony, de este papel, porque hablas un poco como del paso del tiempo, del paso de los años y cómo los maquilladores se han dado como una tarea exhausta para poder tenerlo bien claro y que quede bien personificado precisamente el papel que estás haciendo. Pero ¿qué tan fácil es para un actor reconocido, recordado por convertirse de alguna manera en algún momento de la vida en un sex symbol, ese paso de los años en la televisión, en la pantalla y de pronto ver que has tomado la oportunidad de pasar a ser director, a escribir y que finalmente esa imagen de pronto con la que muchos se quedan se va desvaneciendo? Y dos, hablabas del tema del video en el que pudiste hacer parte al lado de Britney Spears y hace unos días vimos lo que sucedió ante el juez de Los Ángeles cuando Britney le pide precisamente que acabe con esa tutela que le da el control de su vida a su padre y a su manager. Yo quería preguntarte, ustedes como actores, tú como director, como libretista también, entiendo que hay un gremio gigante precisamente allí apoyando esta causa y apoyando precisamente a esta artista. ¿Cuál es tu papel o tu rol o lo que opinas frente al tema también?
Jason, the first question in Spanish, she just said from Colombia is, you are known as a sex symbol. How difficult it was for you to step in a role that made you change in a dramatic way the pass of time in BC Andrews. You were from sexy symbol to almost literally grandpa in front of everybody's eyes in the blink of the eye. Did your ego was hurt at a certain point?
No, my ego wasn't hurt at all. I actually really relished the opportunity to do that. I haven't had much opportunity to do any aging makeup like that. So for me, I looked at it as a wonderful challenge. I think the last time I really did any full aging prosthetics like that was sort of was in an episode of Beverly Hills 90210 where I did a scene with myself, where Brandon did a scene with a jeweler called Mr. Frudenberg, and he went to Frudenberg's jewelry store, and I played the old jeweler that Brandon went to go buy a ring from, and I made myself up to look like a 75-year-old man in a jewelry store. So I think at that point in time in the show, I was just looking at ways to keep myself entertained. So for me, no, I didn't feel like I didn't feel like my ego was taking a blow by making myself up to look like an old man. I understood the scope of the project that we were tackling, and I really enjoyed that part of it. We shot Gates of Paradise first, which was the movie where I played, where Tony was the old man, and that one was set in the 80s. And then we went back and we shot the other movies that the one in the 60s, the one in the early 70s, and the one we shot them all out of order. So I did the old man makeup first, which was probably the only thing that made that made it the most difficult, because we did the old man makeup first.
And the second question was, everybody's talking these days, and it's up to you if you want to answer or not. Everybody's talking these days about Britney and the court and all that. Do you have any opinion, any comment about that?
No, because I don't know enough about the legality of it.
More than fair enough. Thank you, Jason. Now we have a question from Argentina. And the question from Argentina will be, what is that excites you the most about this saga coming to countries like Argentina? And what reference do you have from Argentina? The question comes from Virginia Bruno from El Día newspaper.
I'm just excited for people to see these movies. And anyone who's a fan of the books, I think will really enjoy these movies. Like if you read the Castile a series of books, I think you'll really enjoy the movies. I think we did a really nice job and a really faithful adaptation of the books. I don't really have any memories of Argentina. Not yet. I've always wanted to go to Buenos Aires, but I haven't made it there yet. Hopefully someday soon.
Not yet. Also, we has another question from the social media fans from Lifetime saying that you love to cook. And if you love to cook, if you ever consider the idea to have a cooking show.
I do love to cook. It's true. And would I ever have a cooking show? Sure. Yeah, I guess I could have a cooking show. I just have to like figure out what the spin on it would be, because it feels like there's a lot of cooking shows on the air already.
For sure. We have now a question from El Mercurio Chile. You're starring other movies based on B.C. Andrews' books. What about your stories do you think is appealing both from you as an actor and from you as a director, but also why you were pushing to be appealing to the viewers?
Well, I think, well, yes. I think that V.C. Andrews novels have resonated with readers for so long because they're representative of a certain segment of American society. And I think that they give people a window into that society. Although it is a very overly dramatized, heightened view into that society. I think it allows people to sort of view something through a one-way mirror. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. They're viewing something in an interrogation room, and I think it sort of feels a little bit voyeuristic, and I think that people enjoy that, and I think that's why. These movies will resonate with people as well. It sort of gives people a view into other people's lives that they feel like maybe they shouldn't be watching so much.
So it's a guilty pleasure, Lifetime movies, indeed.
100%. Guilty pleasure. Well put. Yeah.
Now, the second question, and about talking about guilty pleasures, so you better watch out, is it seems that you enjoy way too much to be a director. Are you planning to be a director full time?
I do enjoy directing, and I sort of split my time pretty evenly these days. Like right now I'm just directing, and I'm sure that one day I will just exclusively direct, and there have been periods in my life where I've just exclusively direct. So I'm sure that day is coming for me.
Perfect, Mariana. What is the next question?
Yes, from Brazil, Luciano Guaraldo from UOL.
Perfect.
Hi, Jason. Hi, everyone. I have a two-part question. First one is about the makeup to getting old. How long did that process take daily? And secondly, about guilty pleasures, not only the D.C. Andrews, but guilty pleasures in general, why do you think, and Carmen can jump in as well, why do you think they're so successful, especially in these days where the pandemic is stressing everyone out and they sort of feel like a escapism from reality and we can just enjoy this over the top for 2 hours?
So you understand that he's referring to Lifetime movies as a guilty pleasures as well. Jason, go for it.
Yes, 100%. What was the first question again?
How long did the makeup take?
I'm sorry. Yes, of course. That old age makeup took about 3 hours in the morning to put on, and then it would take me about an hour to take off at night. So it was quite a lengthy process, but one I think was definitely worth it. Cause it was, cause I think, you know, Pearl did a great job, on it every day. I think we made these movies, and these movies aired, originally, here in, you know, in America and in Canada, before the pandemic, and they were, very successful here. But I think that, the pandemic makes this kind of guilty pleasure, even better. I mean, I think that everybody needs, escapism, even more now. So I think that, watching these kind of movies now would be, even better. You know, I think they're just perfect for these kind of times.
And the second question was, first for Jason and then for Carmen, was also from Brazil, and he was asking Luciano, what do you think the guilty pleasures, like the life, the movies, matter so much and work so well, especially in the pandemic days?
Why do they work so well? Well, I think everybody likes to escape from their day-to-day problems. And, certainly this pandemic has piled even more problems on everybody. And, I think being able to get away from it is incredibly important and also therapeutic. So I think people should take advantage of it, anytime they can.
Carmen, ¿por qué crees que las películas de Lifetime son un placer culposo y gustan tanto a la gente?
I totally agree. Estoy totalmente de acuerdo. Creo que, sobre todo en momentos donde tenemos más tiempo para consumir, en momentos de pandemia hemos buscado contenidos que nos hagan, pues, que sean relevantes, que nos recuerden quizá alguna época de nuestra adolescencia, de nuestra infancia, no sé. Y en este caso, V.C. Andrews ha sido una saga de libros súper importante para los que crecimos leyendo Flores en el Ático y que posteriormente, pues, vimos con la serie de Castel y ahora podemos ver con esta serie nueva de Landry. Y creo que lo que tiene es que en las generaciones anteriores lo vimos en los libros, lo leímos, lo disfrutamos, y en generaciones nuevas lo pueden ver a través de Lifetime Movies. Entonces, creo que nos hace llevarnos a unos mundos, como decías tú, César, intrigantes, apasionados, únicos, y qué mejor manera de hacerlo a través de Lifetime Movies. Yo particularmente me acuerdo de haber leído esos libros que eran, bueno, espectaculares, que todo el mundo hablaba de ellos, y hoy en día pues ha sido una de las sagas más exitosas dentro del canal. Sin duda tenemos una audiencia que le encanta, que cada vez que decimos V.C. Andrews, se vierte a la pantalla porque tiene todos estos elementos que hace que sea un contenido muy especial para nuestra audiencia. Y en general, Carmen, todos los contenidos que vienen de libros tienen fans que nos siguen en las pantallas.
Carmen, pero además, hablando de V.C. Andrews y de Lifetime Movies, lo que han hecho ahora con programación, sobre todo por la pandemia y por la forma como está evolucionando las plataformas, tenemos la posibilidad de verlo a nivel lineal, o sea, en la televisión, a través también de VOD en cualquier device o cualquier dispositivo, y también tienes una maratón para Brasil el día 24, para América Latina el día 25, y todo VOD a partir del 1 de julio. Cuéntanos, ¿cómo hacemos para disfrutar de la mejor manera de esta maratón al mejor estilo Lifetime?
Muchas gracias. Bueno, los fines de semana de julio lo pueden ver tanto en Brasil como en el resto de América Latina. Los sábados y domingos vamos a estar estrenando las películas de la nueva saga de Landry. Como dices tú, en VOD lo que significa es que a través del servicio de VOD lo pueden ver a nivel maratón. Están disponibles todas las películas de esta saga y pueden, bueno, disfrutarlo a su ritmo, a su manera de quererlo ver, de escoger las películas, y que sin duda vamos a poderlo ver. A partir del 1 de julio va a estar disponible en el VOD y tenemos más de 12 películas en esa colección y van a poder compartir.
Muchas gracias. Ahora continuamos con más preguntas, Mariana.
Yes, Sebastián Tavares from Pop Radio Argentina.
Hello, Jason. How are you? Nice to meet you.
Hey.
Hey, so you're adapting Jackie Collins' Hollywood Kids for an hour series. Is that some kind of going back to your roots? to Beverly Hills 90210 and put a spin on it after 20 years?
Well, it could be considered kind of a version of that. I think it's sort of maybe a cross between Beverly Hills 90210 and Entourage, maybe. I think that would sort of be a valid comparison.
Fair enough. Sebastian, do you have a follow-up question?
Since we're talking about Beverly Hills, how do you remember Luke Perry? What are your thoughts on him?
Luke was not only a castmate of mine. Luke was also one of my very, very dear friends, losing him at such a young age was a tragedy, and one that me and my family still haven't yet recovered from, unfortunately.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Mariana, next question, please.
Yes, Eduardo Gutierrez from Quien Magazine, Mexico.
Hello, how are you, Jason? It's very nice to talking to you. I have a two-part question. First of all, I would like to know if it's possible that you can share with us a balance that you did about your career, you know, with the opportunity to be in all the stages of the industry. How good moments, how bad moments do you have? And also as your life as a man, you know, after became a daddy, what that changed for you, everything. And also I would like to know, now that we're talking about BC Andrews as a guilty pleasure, I would like to know if you can tell us which are your guilty pleasures. Thank you very much.
what are the good parts and the bad parts about being in this business? You know, I mean, being in this business for as long as I have, I've sort of seen all sides of this business, and it's a wonderful business, but it can also be a very hard business and a very cruel business sometimes. And I think that the most important thing about having longevity in this business is to never lose your imagination and never lose the desire to challenge yourself. And I think that that's what keeps you moving forward in the business, and that's what keeps you relevant. And so that's what I've always tried to do, and it seems to be working out for me so far. So that's what advice I give to anybody who asks me, you know, how to have a career that has some sort of longevity. Just try to stay motivated and try to keep yourself from getting jaded by the business, because it's easy to get that way. How has fatherhood changed things for me? Well, I mean, fatherhood is the greatest single thing that ever happened to me. I love my kids more than anything, and as much as kids complicate your life, they've also simplified my life in amazing ways, because everything I do now, I just do for my kids. So that has made my life so much fuller and so much simpler at the same time. Can't imagine my life without them. And they are everything to me.
The last question that he asked you, Jason, is like, what are your guilty pleasures now?
Oh, my guilty pleasures now. Exactly. Right. I forgot about that one. What are my guilty pleasures now? Wow. What are my guilty pleasures now? I feel like I just don't even have time for guilty pleasures anymore.
Cooking?
Yeah, I'm getting to the age where, like, even, having steak is like a guilty pleasure because I'm worried about my cholesterol. It's a tragedy, right?
Great answer. Next question, Mariana, please.
Yeah, from Brazil, from Folha de São Paulo, Vitor Moreno.
Hi, Jason. I'm Vitor Moreno from Folha de São Paulo, Brazil. Very nice to be talking to you because I was a big fan of 90210. And my question is, what do you find more appealing today as an actor? Playing a good guy like Brandon Walsh or a troubled character like Tony Tarterton?
I think I find more challenges in playing characters like Tony Tatterton, to tell you the truth. There certainly are challenges in playing good guys like Brandon Walsh, but there are far more challenges in taking a character like Tony Tatterton and in finding ways to make a character like that still likable to an audience. And finding ways to make him charming and charismatic, even though characters like Tony are doing very questionable things. So I seem to be more attracted to troubled characters like that these days.
Mariana, next question.
Yes, from Reforma newspaper, Mexico, Juan Carlos García.
Hello, right here. Hello, everyone. Hi, Jason. This is Juan Carlos. Very nice to talk to you. I have two-part question. The first one is, what would be for you the which do you consider is the main difference between the time when you started and the time that we are living now in the industry of entertainment? Because streaming has changed everything, technology. And what would be an advice specifically for new generations that it seems that a lot of them, they are looking for fame more than for talent. And the other one would be, a lot of people say experience is learning. Which is the biggest regret in your professional life?
Well, the biggest difference in the industry now from when I started, I believe, is the influence of social media. Because social media is not only has an influence on famous people, it also has an influence on the way people get famous and what it means to be famous. And I think that also leads into your other question about fame and about people. People have a desire for fame without actually being famous for anything and what that means. And I think that is an incredibly dangerous and slippery slope. And I feel like it's the whole Kardashian question, right? Like, you have this whole family of people that are famous for just being famous, right? Like they don't really have any discernible talents. Like they didn't, like I went to theater school and I learned how to be an actor, and I got famous because I was on a television show because I was a successful actor, right? Like I achieved something and my fame grew out of that. But then there's a whole generation of people that are now famous because they're YouTubers. So they're famous because they open packages on their YouTube channel and they've become famous for that. And what kind of fame is that? And what does that mean? And those people, but those people make tons of money. And is that all it's about? And what is fame really? What does fame really mean anyway? And these are all important questions. And I think that I think that they're all very difficult to answer. I think that the meaning of fame has changed as technology has changed and access to fame has changed, because you can be famous and monetize fame in a way that you couldn't before. So I think your question is correct. What is fame, and how do you quantify fame? And I don't think I know the answer. I know why I became famous, and I know what I did to become famous, but I didn't set out to become famous. I set out to become a successful actor, and fame was a byproduct of that. But I think you're right. There is an entire generation of young people who just want to be famous, and I feel like they don't even know what that means.
His follow-up question, Jason, was, do you have any regrets?
Do I have any regrets? No, I don't have any regrets. I don't have any regrets.
That's a lot to say.
Well, no, that's not exactly, that's not entirely true. I do have one regret. I didn't get a university degree. That's the one regret that I have. And I wish that I would have taken the time to go do that. And I'm going to make sure that my kids do that.
But you can do it now. Mm-hmm. Other people, they have done it in the 50s or something. No?
They've done what, sir?
You can do it. You can try to have your college degree. A lot of people, they have done it in the 40s, 50s.
I can. I know. I just need to find the time. The problem is I'm always at work, and it's hard to find the time. Maybe when I slow down a little bit, I'll find the time to go back.
That would never happen, Jason. We know how you work. Mariana, next question.
Yes, from Colombia. Claudia Arango from El Colombiano newspaper.
It's a pleasure to talk with you, Jason. My name is Claudia, and my question is about how have you seen the transition, the growth of television? For example, today in Colombia, we enjoy more Canadian series than before. You can see a Latin series. That generates more work for you and, I don't know, more critical public too. How do you see it?
I think it's wonderful. I think the global reach of television now is very exciting, and I think that the digital platforms and the way that they share international content around the globe is super exciting, because there's wonderful scripted content coming from Colombia, coming from India, coming from Spain, coming from Italy, coming from Israel, coming from all around the world. And we all get to share in this sort of global digital melting pot now, which is very exciting. The Scandinavians create incredible scripted content. I think it's super exciting, and I think the more we all get to share, the better it is for everybody.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jason. We have one. Thank you, Claudia. We have one more question, and this one is from Brazil. Mariana, you ready?
Yes, he's from Lorraine Perricho from the site Entre Tiseis.
Hello, Jason. Hello, everyone. My name is Lorraine Perillo. I'm from Brazil, Entre Tiseis. And first of all, I'd like to say that I grew up watching 90210, so I'm a big fan, and it is so nice to meet you. And my questions, I actually have two questions, and is about the Landry series. What aspects made the VC Andrew stories so interest to you for you to work with them? And what scene moment or moments stood up out the most for you, and why?
What attracted me and what stood out for me most? Well, tackling the character of Tony Chatterton was a big challenge for me. So he he really attracted me to the series, because I knew that that was going to be tough. And then also the opportunity to direct the movie of Fallen Hearts, I knew was going to be a big challenge as well. So I, you know, those two things were really the big calling cards for me to attach myself to the series. And then the big things that I remember, there were the lion attack sequence that I directed in Fallen Hearts. That was a big moment for all of us on that film, because that was a big sequence in that film. Also, there was another big sequence that we had to shoot in a maze, like a tree maze that our character that Annalise Basso got lost in, and then she finds another character shooting that was a big challenge as well.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
We also have a question from Lalo Gonzalez from Grupo Asir Mexico. His question is like, since your early days on television, how much do you think have changed the role of a woman behind and in front of the camera?
I've seen women's roles increase quite a bit, which has been nice to see. Luckily for me, Aaron Spelling was always really good about hiring a lot of females, female directors, female producers. So I've been working with a lot of females in those kind of capacities since the early 90s. So this push in the last, you know, 3 or 4 years to have more inclusivity, certainly in the director's chair has, which I think has been wonderful. You know, it's been a long time coming. We were very, very aware of that even back in the 90s on Beverly Hills 90210, and even on my other shows, you know, on Call Me Fitz, we had lots of female directors, and on Private Eyes, we've always had lots of female directors and lots of BIPOC directors. You know, we've always been very aware of being inclusive. But I think that having more female voices, in the director's chair and in the writer's room. And I've always preferred to work with female editors myself, because I feel like it's important to balance male and female voices. Always when you're working in film and television. So the world that we're in today, where we're trying to balance things out, I think is something that we should have been doing for a long time now, and it's good that it's finally here.
Jason, we want to thank you from the bottom of our hearts today for your participation. We were expecting to find Brandon Walsh today, or maybe some kind of chase of Tony today. But we were able to find out what's actually more impressive, because we were able to meet that family man, that human being with the amazing heart that everybody has been always talking about. And we cannot be more grateful that your priorities are in order. It's such a fresh air to find someone like you that's able to share with his heart in his hand, his story, his life, his perspective, with no fear, just with love. And that's the way we love it. Your honesty is refreshing, and your talent is amazing. In front of the cameras and behind the cameras, we're expecting to see much more from you. But thank you so much for allowing us to get into your heart and to the doors of your house today and get to know the real you, Jason, a wonderful human being with the priorities just in the best order, and a family man who has a lot to share, even his guilty pleasures, and keep eating meat, but only once per week, because cholesterol, it could be a danger for you.
Oh my God, thank you so much. You're very kind, thank you.
Thank you so much, Jason. All the very best. Thank you, Carmen. Thank you. Gracias a todos los que nos acompañaron. Recuerden que el estreno es el 14 de julio en Brasil, el 17 de julio en América Latina, el 24 de julio podrán ver la maratón en Brasil, el 25 de julio en toda América Latina. Y recuerden, está disponible en VOD a partir del 1 de julio. No se pierdan la saga maravillosa de BC Andrews, con Flores, con Castell y ahora con Ruby Laundry, al mejor estilo de Lifetime Movies. Como dijo Jason, hablemos de Guilty Pleasure, hablemos de Escape, y qué mejor que con Lifetime Movies. Gracias, Jason. Thank you so much.
Gracias,
gracias Carmen. Gracias a todos. Gracias, Alex.
Muchas gracias.
Adiós.
I don't even get a hug.
Oh my God!
Yeah, it's been a long night and the mirror's telling me to go home.
But it's been tell me how to find Leigh Van Vreen's family.
You know what would happen if anyone found out about you?
Never get anything past you, could I, Kathy?
Like it or not, we are sisters.
That doesn't make us friends.
Giselle Dumas conoce a Ruby Laundry, tu hermana.
Algo malo va a suceder.
Supe que eres una chica del pantano.
¡Ah! ¡Son animales!
Si todo resulta como quieres, mereces que te culpen.
Logan, él es mi abuelo político, Tony.
Por favor, siéntanse en su casa.
¿Estás bien?
¿Cuántos secretos aún escondes de mí?
Todo lo hice porque te amo.
¡Soy tu hija!
La familia lo es todo, y ahora somos familia.
Mientras más intentes huir de esto, con más fuerza te seguirá.
Esto es solo el principio.
¿Ni siquiera un abrazo?
Hubo un accidente.
Podemos ir a vivir con su abuela.
¡Palático!
¿Cuánto tiempo?
No lo sé exactamente, tal vez unos días o una semana.
Me casaré, mamá.
Yo no tengo una hija.
Renunciaste a nuestro amor por dinero. Nos encerraste en el ático por 3 años.